What's up, everyone?
Welcome to church. Come on.
Welcome in. It's good to see you guys. Been without seeing you. We're glad you're here, is a better way to put it.
Absolutely. We're sitting here on the Rolling Meadows Worship Center stage.
Wow.
And we've kind of made a little living room.
Yeah.
So welcome to the service from our living room to yours. Or really,
worship center.
Our worship center to your
living room, essentially.
To your worship center.
Man, it is great to be back in the room at Rolling Meadows.
Yes, it is.
And we're all online and digital, but we are here, and it's just good to be back in the room, Tommy.
Exactly. Yeah.
I love it.
Me too. I could not be happier than this moment right here. Can't wait till it's full of people once again.
Truly.
Well, listen, speaking of being in the room, we would love to know who's here today.
Yep.
And so, we'd love for you to check in right now. You could do that a couple of different ways. You could do it right here on the website. Right in the top, it says check in. You could click on that button, or you could open it up on the Harvest app, and you can check in that way too. We just love knowing that you're here. Love being able to pray for people who leave prayer requests. So please and thank you for checking in online. Well, we've got a special service today. Really excited. We've got Pastor Jeff Thompson. He's preaching today. He's bringing the word. And so excited. He's the campus pastor of adult ministries at our Chicago Cathedral campus, and he is bringing the word today.
And he is bringing it right here in Rolling Meadows. We mentioned that we're back, and it has been a while since we've been in this room.
Yeah.
We've actually got a picture. Look at this picture quick. This is the last time that all of us were in our worship centers together and worshiping. Feels like a lifetime ago.
Yes.
It was actually March the 8th. A Sunday morning, we were here in Meadows. I was here for that service, and we were at all of our campuses across Chicagoland. And we're going to do a quick giveaway right now.
I love giveaways.
I need you to tell me, how many days has it been since that day, the last time we were in the service, March the 8th? Tell me in the comments. The first person to say it is going to win a prize, and you're going to win a signed copy of a picture of myself and Tommy right here on the stage.
Whoa.
Correct. Or a Starbucks gift card. You get to choose. But,
I mean, signed copy.
I mean,
come on.
This is a good little show we've got going here. But tell me how many days it's been since that March the 8th, and we're going to give away a prize for that.
First person.
We're back on the stage, and we're slowly entering back into worship. As soon as we can get everyone back together, we're excited about that. And we're going to have some people together because we are going to camp.
Yes,
student ministry is going to Camp Harvest. We've been leaving in a couple of days, and I am so excited about that.
Me too.
The dates are going to be coming on your screen. They're going to be coming later in the announcements as well. And we have very, very limited spots left for registration. And so if you are not signed up yet, we would love for you to be able to come if there are spots available. And so you can check online, or you can reach out to the student pastor at your campus, and they can let you know what needs to happen so that your student can join us at Camp Harvest, because we believe it is going to be incredible. The Lord is going to do some amazing things, and we're so excited about
that. And there's very few spots left.
Very few.
Like in the single digits.
Correct.
Yeah.
So get signed up. Because we are doing that this summer. We're so excited about it. And Harvest has stayed pretty active. We said it's been a while since we've been in the building, but we have not failed to connect with one another and to be active as a church. And we have been doing a Harvest summer. And so don't forget about that. We are engaging with mind, body, and soul challenges. The first is of the mind, and we are reading Reconciliation Blues. And so if you have not gotten a copy of that yet, we would love for you to grab a copy so that we can engage in that together. And so that is the mind piece. What about the body piece?
Yeah, so the body piece is the 8-8-3 challenge.
Okay.
And it is sleeping 8 hours a night.
I love that.
That's an eight. I've been really, like, intentionally doing that one.
Yeah, that's one of those where, like, I mean, I guess if you really want me to.
I guess I'll sleep 8 hours a night.
Okay, so that's the first
eight. That's the first one. The first eight is sleep 8 hours a night. The second eight is drink 8 glasses of water a day.
Okay.
And that one's been a little bit tougher for me.
Well, coffee's essentially water.
It's 95% water.
I count that. I've been doing that every day.
In just coffee?
Probably. Probably. I need to step up the water game. But that's eight glasses of water.
Yeah. Yep, 8 glasses of water a day. And then the last thing is get 30 minutes of exercise, whatever that means for you.
Whoa.
3 times a week. So 30 minutes.
Okay.
3 times a week. That's the 8-8-3 challenge for our body challenge this July.
I love that. And we want to all engage in that challenge. And listen, we work with students. We know how it works.
Yeah.
If you want to get someone to do something, you give something away.
Exactly.
We're used to that. And so we're going to give away one more thing. Hopefully the chat's like blowing up right now.
Yes.
With people trying to guess how many first days. Trivia yep. question.
They want the picture.
Yeah, they want the picture of us. The second challenge, you can be back in the comments blowing up. Trivia question. Usain Bolt set a record, and he ran 400 meters in 45 seconds.
Wow.
Which is crazy.
Yeah.
My question is, we're trying to, you know, get 30 minutes of exercise.
Yeah.
How many miles could he run in 30 minutes if he kept that pace the entire time?
Wow.
He ran 400 meters in 45 seconds. How many miles could he run in 30 minutes
with that 45 second pace for 400 meters?
For 400 wow. meters.
So you have to do some math.
Let me
on
know
this
in
one.
The chat.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let us know in the chat, and we'll reach out to you about a giveaway for that.
Yeah.
And we're gonna give away a copy of Reconciliation Blues.
Yes.
So that you're able to engage in the mind portion of the Harvest Summer. So.
And again, it's the first person to comment or the closest person.
Sure.
If no one gets it right.
Math is hard. I understand. That's okay.
Yeah.
The last part, our challenge of soul, is that we are challenging our people to observe a 24-hour weekly Sabbath. And Colleen and I have been doing that for the past few months, and it is amazing. And I want to give you an extra challenge for that. Do it without your phone. I'm telling you, plug in your phone, leave it on the dock, the charging station for a day, and just connect with the Lord, with your family, with the people around you, and it will truly bless your soul. Yeah. And so we want to challenge everyone with that.
Absolutely.
And so that's our Harvest Summer. And if you're just joining us, I know that we've been on for a couple minutes, but people are coming in slowly. We want to welcome you.
Welcome Heath, to church.
Tommy, we're on the stage at Rolling Meadows right now. We're excited about church. And we want you to check in. And so we can check in on the website.
Yep.
You can check in on the app. You can check in through the comment section. We should have a link there for you. Yep. And so we want you to make sure to check in with us. And we want to engage with you. So follow us on social media, on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube. We are at Harvest Bible Chapel. Pretty simple.
Yeah.
Not hard to find. So follow along with us there. All of our content's going to be there from the weekend services, all announcements, things like that. Because we want to connect with you guys digitally before we can connect again in person. So we're looking forward to that, though.
Yeah, absolutely. Heath, you know, we are, you know, we're gearing up for worship in just a couple of minutes. And I think just one thing that we can do together and also encourage our chat to do as they're listening to this is, why don't we share a verse of, you know, a verse that God has been using in your life for the past few weeks? Like, what is a verse that God has used in your life in the past few weeks? And then if you're watching this right now, go ahead and post it in the chat. What is a verse that God has been using in your life the past couple of weeks? We'd love to know. Encourage others with that. And so, Heath, why don't
Absolutely.
You encourage us right now?
I know that we've all had time on our hands. So I've been reading the Word and just reflecting on what the Word is for me. And I just want to read quick Hebrews 4, 12 and 13. The Word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's piercing the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, discerning to the thoughts, intentions of the heart. No creature is hidden from His sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of Him to whom we must give an account. And just thinking about the Word and thinking about what it is for me has been really challenging in the past couple of weeks.
That's so sweet. And both of us are preaching up at junior high camp.
Yeah.
And so obviously those passages are very much like on the front of our minds
Absolutely.
Right now. And so I'm preaching as well, and I've been diving into John 13, which I'm not going to read the whole thing because that'll take a long time because it's a lengthy passage. But it's about Jesus washing the disciples' feet and serving the disciples. Even though He is the Lord, He serves the disciples, which is just a crazy thing. And so just learning from that, learning from Jesus how to serve others, to submit to one another. And I think that that's just a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ serving the disciples. Although you would think it would be the other way around, the disciples serving Jesus, washing His feet. No, the Lord gets down and washes the feet of the disciples. And so I've been really diving into that, trying to, you know, replicate that in my life of serving others. And so listen, if you've got a verse that the Lord has had you in for the past few weeks, or maybe this week, or maybe even for this quarantine, share it in the chat. We'd love to know. We'd love to be encouraged by the Word of God together.
Yeah.
But we're getting ready for worship.
I'm ready.
Let's pray. Let's all pray together. God, we're so excited that we get to be here and to worship You in our living room right here in the worship center and living rooms across Chicagoland and beyond. Lord, You are with us, and we are so excited to worship Your name and to give You all of the glory. Lord, thank You for meeting with us here through singing worship and through Your Word and Lord, be with us now. Let us lean forward. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship.
Well, hey, church, we're so glad that you're joining us to worship our God together. We're going to ascribe worth to him. Let's exalt his name together. Yes, we love you, Lord. Come and meet with us now. Spirit, meet. Change our lives.
Change everything. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished and the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. Heart could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame.
Thank you, Lord.
The cross is spoken, I am forgiven, 'cause the King of Kings, he calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Come on, lift a hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence came a roaring lion and declared the grave has no claim on the
hey!
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body, it just began to silence.
has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Amen and amen. What a great song to sing about the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. And we get to see that now because we have some baptisms, church, from our Elgin campus. So let's watch those right now. Here we go.
This is my friend Troy. Troy is here to get baptized. Troy, tell us, when was it that you came to know Jesus?
Yes, in February of 2019, my family was looking for a church home. And it wasn't until we came to Harvest that the message touched me. And I had the desire to want to know more and learn more about Jesus Christ. And in April of 2019 is when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
That's fantastic. And Troy, what has Jesus been doing in your life since then?
Usually I would have just gone about my life as normal, but since then I have had a willingness to learn and gain knowledge and also to reach out to others and tell them about Jesus Christ.
You want to witness and tell people about the Lord?
Yes.
That's fantastic. Yes. So Troy, why do you want to be baptized today?
Today I want to be baptized because I'm ready. I want the world to know that I am ready to walk with Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Well, you've done that. And so Troy, because of your profession of faith in Christ alone for your salvation, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Nice. Well, we're still here in Elgin because we have the opportunity now to help Cassie, Troy's wife, to be baptized. That's so sweet, isn't it? And so Cassie, tell us, when was it that you came to know Christ?
So for me, it was in the summer of August of 2014. It was right after my daughter was born. And I remember the pastor was preaching a sermon about how much Jesus loves all of us, and for some reason it really stuck with me, and it really made me realize that I needed him in my life for his spiritual guidance, because I can't do it without him.
That's right. And so that was the moment that you trusted Christ.
Yes, that's
for your salvation.
When I fully accepted him into
Fantastic.
My life and my heart.
No other way. In Christ alone.
That's right.
Fantastic. And so what's he been doing in your life since then?
So for me, most recently, he's been giving me a sense of peace and hope. These past couple months have been causing anxiety sometimes, and it's been nice to know that the Lord's there to help you with the hard times to get you through it.
That's right.
Before him, there's moments I probably would have been freaking out, but with him by my side, I know there was peace and we can overcome anything.
That's so great. Mm-hmm. And so why do you want to be baptized today, Cassie?
I want to declare to the world that I'm ready to live my life for God.
You've done that. And so, Cassie, because of your profession of faith in Christ alone for your salvation, I baptize you now. We baptize you now in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Did it. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Amen and amen. What a powerful name, the name of Jesus. Well, it is so good to be with all of you today. My name is John Smith, and I serve as the co-campus pastor here at the Rolling Meadows campus. And I just want to extend a warm welcome to all of you to Harvest Bible Chapel Online.
And my name is Ramirez Moody. I serve as one of the pastors at our Rolling Meadows campus. If this is your first time joining us today, we just want to say welcome and thank you for joining us. We're so glad that you're with us this evening. Whether this is your first time or maybe you've been tuning in with us every weekend, I'd like to invite you to check in. You can check in on this page or on the Harvest app or in the comments section on the link. We just want to know that you're here, and we'd also like to know how we can be praying for you this week.
Well, Harvest, July is a great month. You know why I like July? I love July because July is synonymous with student ministry and Camp Harvest. And I am just so excited to let you know that some of our students are going to be leaving this Tuesday to go up to camp. And so parents, would you be praying for our junior hires from all of our campuses who are going up there, that they would have a great time, that they would be spiritually filled, and that the Lord would meet them right where they're at. Hey parents, if you've got a student in the high school age, there's 2 weeks set aside for them. July 19th is going to be the week set aside for those who attend our Elgin and our Crystal Lake campus. So space is limited, so sign up. You're not going to want to have them miss that week. And if you're a part of our Rolling Meadows or our Cathedral campus or Aurora or Deerfield Road, you are going to want to have your kids be a part of the high school week on July 19th through 25th. God has been so faithful to show up there in great ways, so be a part of it. Don't miss out.
Okay, Harvest, how are we doing with our summer challenge, mind, body, and soul? Well, we hope that you are doing well. In fact, for the month of July, we can all participate in a new and interesting way. We'll be reading through a book together this month. It's a book called Reconciliation Blues by Edward Gilwith. You'll have an opportunity, and you have time, to purchase the book and read through the book and be prepared to do the study that we are doing on July 30th at 7:30. So Harvest, you have time to do this. Get your books, hurry, and join us, okay? Please take advantage of this opportunity this summer to stretch the minds that God has blessed us with.
That's so great. Well, Harvest, so many of you have been praying for who it is that is going to be our lead teaching pastor. And so we have been partnering with a firm, and they have been looking for candidates, and they are going to present those candidates to our search committee this week. And so would you be praying for this whole process as they present those names, as interviews happen, that those who are involved, that all of us would be praying for wisdom and knowledge and discernment and who God would have for us. And for more information and updates, go to harvestbiblechapel.org/search. You know, God has been so faithful, and he's been reminding himself of his faithfulness to our church in these days. And I just got to say thank you so much for the generosity, to the way that God has been faithful to you. You have been faithful to the church. And remind us of the four ways that we can give during this time. We can give through our website. We can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We can give by texting. Or if you choose to give through snail mail, just mail your check to the Rolling Meadows campus.
Pastor John, I'm so excited about the person who will be bringing us the word this evening.
Yeah.
A face who is pretty familiar to most of us, but might not be familiar to some. It's Pastor Jeff Thompson.
Amen.
He's a campus pastor of adult ministries at our Cathedral campus. And Jeff loves the Lord. He loves his word, and he loves Chicago. Him and his wife, Sarah Beth, have three children, two boys and a girl. And we are so blessed to have him bring us the word this weekend. So before we continue to praise the Lord, let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to gather together to praise your Son, Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for everything that you've done and even everything that you're going to do in our church. You've been such a blessing to us, and we're just so grateful. So, God, we offer these gifts to you as a show of sacrifice and worship to you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Barely hanging on by a thread of hope, hard to see beyond everything unknown. And with your strength I'll stand, it's all I can do. I will lift my hands and sing my way through you. So when I'm broken and my weakest in my darkest hour, yeah, I'll let my worship be a weapon on this battleground. And from the depths of the lowest place, and I will be the highest praise, the highest praise. And I am hanging on to every word you speak. I can see beyond into the victory. Lord, you never left. Lord, you never changed. And all my comfort. Has to flee when we worship, when we respond with worship. We know this, come on. Because the cross has put the enemy to shame.
Yes, Lord.
And now my song echoes through an empty grave. Yeah. My song of worship, because the cross has put the enemy to shame. We know this today. And now my song echoes through an empty grave.
Oh, know that we're in a terrible place. When it seems like we're in the wilderness, our response should be worship. Because the word says that when we worship, the enemy actually flees. He can't be around the presence of God, so the enemy literally trembles. So I just want to worship. I want to take this time to worship in your trouble. Worship in your afraidness. When you don't know where to go, our response should be worship. So let's sing that chorus one more time.
When I'm broken in my weakest, in my lungs, I'll let my worship be a weapon. I'll let it rise up from the depths of the lowest place. I will give you the highest praise, the highest praise, the highest praise, the highest praise, the highest praise.
That's why we gather, is to give the Lord Jesus all of our praise. And wherever you're at today, whether it's a mountaintop or a valley, we come to worship him. And we come to hear from his word. So grab a hold of your Bible. We're going to turn over to Mark 13. We've been so encouraged by learning more and more about Jesus, just Jesus, now our suffering King. And I've been so encouraged by all that the Lord has been doing through this text. It's been really a relaxing time, actually, for me lately as I've been studying this text. I've been on vacation for a bit. And, you know, a funny thing happens when you disconnect from everything, from when you turn off your phone and you stop thinking about all of the things that you need to do. And especially for those of us who tend to be the go, go, go type and have a long to-do list, when you just stop, there's no more tasks, no meetings, no to-do list, no alarms. Oh, thank the Lord, no alarms. It's just a great feeling when we can relax in that way. Now, some of you, when your alarm goes off, you hop right out of bed, don't need any coffee, and go off to the day. We'll pray for you. But for most of us, when our alarm goes off, it looks a little more like this, that we need some time. We need a few alarms to go off when we're preparing to get to work. A funny thing also happens when we're getting up for something that's a little more interesting to us. It might look like this. Our alarm clock may go off once and we're right out of bed for something fun. But whatever the case, we trust our alarms to tell us, to wake us up for what's ahead of us. And in our text today, Jesus is going to urgently call us to wakefulness as we await his return. Let's pray together. Father, we are so, so grateful for the opportunity to worship you. Lord, you alone are worthy of all that we have and all that we could give. And God, we thank you for your word that you so kindly and graciously instruct us, even in the difficult times, that your words are true, that your words will come to pass. And we're grateful for your word to us. Would you speak to us from your holy scriptures tonight for our good and for your glory? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So grab your Bible, turn to Mark 13. We've been looking at Mark 13 for this is the third week now. Now remember, this section of Mark 13 is known as the Olivet Discourse. This is where Jesus is seated up on the Mount of Olives across the valley from the temple. And as they're looking at the temple, Jesus is teaching his followers some important truths. And so verse 1 of chapter 13 that we looked at 2 weeks ago, they're sitting there looking at this temple, and the disciples say, like, look at these wonderful stones, these beautiful buildings that are here. And Jesus says, you know, this temple that's beautiful and that's so significant to the Jewish people, it's going to be destroyed. There's not going to be a single stone left on top of one another. And so then these four disciples, Peter and James and John and Andrew, these four brothers who were some of the closest to Jesus while he was here on earth, they came to Jesus and pulled him to the side and said privately,
you got to tell us. Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished? So Jesus is here in his Olivet Discourse. He's talking privately with a few of his closest followers, and we get the privilege of listening in on how he answers them. Now, Pastor Dave Stone has walked us through some really deep waters, some challenging sections of God's word. These last 2 weeks, we've been looking at some of the warnings that Jesus gives his followers. It's a sobering reality, this great tribulation that's to come. He says that it's so significant, it's more significant than anything that's ever happened, and nothing will be like it afterwards. And here in Mark 13, we're going to start in verse 28 and following. Jesus is going to tell his followers, and he's going to tell us, what are we supposed to do about all this? Jesus, how am I supposed to think? How am I supposed to act? How am I supposed to live in the light of this incredible tribulation that's to come? Let's see it in God's word. Mark 13, beginning in verse 28. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come. In the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. It's a very clear message that Jesus gives to us and to all of his followers, to stay awake. We need to live in continual readiness for the return of our King, to be on guard, to be alert every day as that day grows closer. He tells us we're to stay awake. I must be watching. Jesus gives this parable, as he often did, and he tells this parable about a fig tree. And as you look at a fig tree, you can see by the leaves and the buds coming that it's going to be summer soon. Now, I don't know about you, but in the city of Chicago, we don't have any fig trees. But we do have this lilac bush right in front of my house. And every year, those lilacs start blooming, and I know that summer is coming, that the weather is turning, and we can enjoy the great outdoors. That's what Jesus is telling them here. You can look at this plant, this fig tree, and you can see that I'm near, that I'm coming soon, that no matter how bad things get, no matter how significant and great this tribulation is, Jesus is coming. And he's coming very soon. So we need to be watching. We need to be alert. It's like if you've ever taken a really long road trip, you know the importance of staying awake. You know, maybe you stop at Starbucks every 5 miles. Maybe you eat sunflower seeds, or maybe you take an energy drink or listen to loud music or play the license plate game or whatever you do. But whatever the case, it's critical that you stay awake and alert while you're driving, because so much is at stake. And when the stakes are high, my attention needs to be undivided. That's what Jesus is calling us here to expectant watchfulness as we await his return. Now, Jesus says this interesting statement in verse 30. He says, "This generation will not pass away till all these things take place." Now, does Jesus mean the generation that he's talking to? Does he mean, hey, Peter, John, James, Andrew, before you guys die, this is all going to happen? Well, if we look back, Jesus says all of these things. So if we look back in chapter 13, There's a lot of these things that have not happened yet. He means all of these things. The angels, the tribulation, the false prophets, the sun and the moon being darkened, the stars falling, the gospel preached to all nations. He really means all things. And these things hadn't happened in their day, and they haven't happened in ours. So Jesus can't mean the generation that was alive right then. So what does Jesus mean by this? What he means is this generation is the generation that sees the beginning of the tribulation, that sees the branches begin to bud on this fig tree. What he's saying here is once you start seeing these things that we've learned about in the last 2 weeks, these tribulation, the false prophets, the persecutions, all of these things that we've learned, the end will come soon. So when these things start, the generation that's alive, they're not going to be gone before all of this happens. What Jesus is saying is when this all starts, it's going to happen really quick. And all of heaven and earth will pass away. But then Jesus says this beautiful statement, my words will not pass away. Isaiah says, the grass withers and the flower fails, but the word of God will stand forever. While this world and everything that we know has an expiration date stamped to it, aren't you glad that Jesus' words never fail? Someone just said amen in their living room. I love that. Jesus' words never pass away. We can trust them. We can be sure about it. And his word to us today is stay awake, be watching. And stay awake, I must be ready. Verse 32 says, but concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, stay awake, for you do not know when the time will come. You see, up until verse 31, Jesus is answering this second question that the disciples had given. He's answering this question that they've given, and here he turns to then going to the first question. Remember, the second question was, what will be the sign when all of these things are about to be accomplished? He's been telling them this whole time. And then at verse 32, it's, when will these things be? They've been waiting this whole time. Can you see them on the edge of their rock probably as they're sitting there listening? Okay, he's going to get to the first question now. Okay, Jesus, when? And Jesus says, nobody knows. I mean, it's kind of a letdown for these guys, but the short answer is no one knows. I mean, so Jesus, wait. You just told us that we should watch for these signs. You just told us we should be looking at a fig tree, and now you're telling us no one knows? Well, see, there's a tension here because he says that you can know that he's near. You can be alert. You can see these signs. You can sense that Jesus is close. But then no one knows when this surprise tribulation will begin. The text says that we can know that he's near, but no one knows the day or the hour, not even the angels, not even Jesus, only God the Father. And when I read this, it begs the question for me, like, how does Jesus not know? How is he not aware of when he's going to return? But if you remember, Jesus is fully God and fully man. He has a divine nature and a human nature. And many times throughout his time here on earth, we see that he grows tired or he grows hungry. He can be tempted. And apparently, somehow, Jesus can choose to be ignorant about things that aren't necessary or beneficial for him to know at the time. So although he could have known due to his divine nature, he chose not to access that knowledge about the timing of his return. It's a little bit like this. So when I was growing up, we had a rule in our household about presents, about Christmas presents or about birthday presents. It was that, obviously, you could not peek, but if you found the presents and you peeked ahead of time, you don't get the presents. So even though I knew that my parents had those presents hidden at the top of the hall closet or in the corner of the basement behind the box, you know, hypothetically, I didn't go access those presents because I wanted to get them later. I chose not to go see those things. And so if anyone ever claims that they know the exact hour, the exact day that all of this would happen, you could see that Jesus didn't even access that part of his divine nature, that no one knows. So if anyone ever claims that to you, I know exactly when Jesus came, and many have made that claim and sold lots of books. But if anyone makes that claim to you, just take them to this verse. Listen. I don't know. Jesus doesn't even know. You think I should be with Jesus or you? I think it's pretty clear. But no one knows when Jesus will return. And although we can't know when he will come, we can be ready for when he returns. He calls us to be ready, to be on guard, to keep awake. I must be ready at all times because Jesus could come at any time. This means living every single day like it could be our last. There's a group of nurses that care for people on their deathbed, and they gathered together some of the regrets, some of the wishes that people had just before they died, the things that they said, I wish I would have done this, I wish I would have lived a little differently. Here's just a few of them. I wish I wouldn't have compared myself to others. I wish I was more aware of the real world around me. I wish I was more content with what I have. I wish I had walked the walk more. I wish I'd really lived the way that I talked. I wish I hadn't held on to that grudge for so long. And this one, I wish I'd told others how much I love them. Listen, loved ones, our time is short. Don't leave it unsaid. Don't grow lazy in doing what you know you need to do because the days are short. Jesus is coming soon and no one knows when. I must stay awake. I must be ready. And then stay awake. I must be working. Verse 34 and following says, it is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to you all, stay awake. Jesus tells them this parable about this master going away and putting his servants in charge, giving them work, commanding the doorkeeper. None of them know when this master will return. Because he could return at any time, we're to work with faithfulness all the time. That each and every day of our lives should be lived as though he's just right around the corner and the master will return. If you're one of Jesus's followers, you have a job to do. He's given you a role, a gifting. He's given you a calling. He's put you to work for him. And our job is to be ready and to be about the work that he's given to us, to be faithful in all of those things. Are you doing your job? Are you being faithful to the master with all of the things that he's entrusted you with? Are you being faithful as he's away, as you wait expectantly for his return? While we can't see the signs, we can know that he's near. And Jesus' point is that our job isn't to try to find out exactly the day, exactly the hour. I really hope it's like tomorrow at 1:30. That'd be amazing. But our job isn't to try to figure that out. Our job is to be about his work, to be faithful while he's away, and to be expectant and watching for him to return. This doorkeeper needed to remain awake as the master came, both so that he could welcome him, but also so that he could display to the master, I've been faithful the whole time you've been away. I don't know if you're like me. When I was growing up, every time I did something wrong, I got caught. And maybe you're sneakier than I am or something like that. But I felt like everything I did, I got caught. I got in trouble for that. It went all the way to the first year that my wife and I were married, we were on vacation, we decided to get tattoos together. And so we're sitting there getting a tattoo. We went out with my buddy Josh. And so the three of us are there. I'm like in the chair getting a tattoo on my shoulder, mid-tattoo. And my cell phone rings like across the room in my coat. And I turned to my buddy Josh and I said, "Don't answer it, it's my mom." And he reached down and grabbed the phone and he was like, "Dude, it's your mom." I couldn't get away with anything. I got caught every time I did anything. Trust me, you want to be doing what you're supposed to when your mom calls. And I want to be doing what's asked of me when the master returns. We need to be ready every day because it could be any day. Expectancy must characterize every single believer's life. We're to be on guard, to keep awake. You know, so many of us study things that are to happen in the end times in Mark 13 or in Revelation or Daniel or many of the other places that we see it, and so many are confused by it, and so many study it and get fearful, or it brings about anxiety for them. But can I just tell you, for those of us who follow Jesus Christ, the message of the end times, even the darkest parts, it's a message of hope. It's a message of joy, of expectancy, because our King is returning, and we will be here to welcome him. Jesus wins, and we are on his team. The winning team going into the fourth quarter doesn't just put their feet up and wait the clock out. They get on the court, and they get to work. They press on and stay in the game. And his message to us, to his followers, is to be ready at all times because he could return at any time. And so we press on. But the really encouraging thing to me is that, you know, the Bible never tells us that we need to be spectacular. Well, we tell ourselves that. The Bible doesn't tell us that we need to be talented, that we need to be great. It actually doesn't even tell us that we need to finish the work that's given to us. But it does tell us that we need to keep working. It tells us whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all of your might. It tells us to keep your hand to the plow. Listen, God isn't looking for special. He's looking for steadfast. God isn't looking for flashy. He's looking for faithful. God isn't looking for perfect. He's looking for perseverance. That's what he's looking for in us. You can stand firm in the midst of this, of all of the trials of your life, and even this great tribulation that's coming, the worst of it, because he is faithful. And all he's asking us to do is to stay awake and to be about his work, to be faithful with what he's given us to do. God isn't asking you to be concerned with the results of it. He's asking for continual readiness to stay awake. So what does it mean to stay awake? What does it mean to be ready? Well, here's a few things. How do I stay awake? First, get rid of sin. Get rid of sin. Colossians 3:5 says, put to death what is earthly in you. Ephesians 4 says to put our sin away. Matthew 5 tells us that if our eye causes us to sin, we're to tear it out. If our hand causes us to sin, we're to cut it off. He's telling us to take drastic measures to get rid of the sin in our lives. So think about it for a minute. I got caught getting a tattoo. But whatever the sin is that you're harboring, what if Jesus came back right when you were doing that? Right when you were looking at the thing that you shouldn't have been looking at? Right when you were treating that person with hatred and injustice? Right when you were turning again to a substance instead of to Jesus Christ, listen, do whatever it takes to rid your life of sin, to get rid of sin. Here's a few practical things, just some helps to be able to move you along in this process of getting rid of sin. First, confess it to God and repent. Repent means to turn. It means a change of mind. It means to turn away from those things and towards the Lord. So repent of that sin and confess it to God. And then confess it to a brother or sister in Christ. You don't have to go through all the details, but you need to be specific enough with them. You need to be clear with them. And you need to confess it to them. And they'll pray for you. And they'll remind you of God's forgiveness on your behalf. Because Jesus paid for that sin. You don't need to be bound by it anymore. But you need to get rid of it. So confess it to God and repent. Confess it to a brother or sister in Christ. And then make a plan for greater obedience to Jesus Christ. A plan that includes boundaries. I'm not going there anymore. I'm not going to be alone with that person anymore. I'm not putting myself in that situation anymore. A plan that includes boundaries and a plan that includes ongoing accountability. You need someone who will ask you the hard questions about where you've been and what you're doing and where your obedience is. With one another's help, we can work to get rid of sin and be prepared and awake for when Jesus returns. So get rid of sin and then get right with others. Ephesians 4 tells us, don't let the sun go down on your anger. But how many of us are harboring bitterness, harboring anger towards one another? Listen, have the conversation. Resolve the conflict, even if it's painful. Work through those things. Grant forgiveness where it's needed. Apologize. God's word says that he opposes the proud, but his grace rushes to the humble. So humble yourself and get right with others. You don't want to be complacent. You don't want to be lazy about these things. You don't know what day will be your last, so don't miss the opportunity to get right with others. And the third, get to work. Get to work. As I already said, Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Or Colossians 3:23 tells us to, whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men. You are serving the Lord Christ. Don't be complacent. Don't be lazy in your work. The Lord has entrusted you with relationships. Lean into them and influence them for Jesus Christ. The Lord has placed people around you, all around you, who don't yet know Jesus Christ, who are far from God. Don't miss the opportunity to tell the gospel to them. Don't miss the opportunity to call them to repent, to turn from their sins and embrace Jesus Christ by faith, to receive the loving and gracious forgiveness that's so freely given to them. The Lord has entrusted you with time, with talent, with treasure to use for his kingdom. Put them to work for him. Jesus says in John chapter 9, he says, we must work the works of him who sent us while it is still day. Night is coming when no one can work. There will come a day, and it will come soon, that we can no longer work, that our work is complete, and all that remains is our victory with Jesus Christ. But until that day, we stay awake by working for Jesus Christ, by putting our hands to the plow, by being faithful and awake to work for him. This is Tuesday, Mark 13. 48 hours later, Jesus is going to tell Peter that he's going to deny him three times. And a little bit later on Thursday, Peter and James and John, three of the four brothers who are here in this passage, they would be told by Jesus, listen, just remain here and watch. Stay awake and pray. As he experienced a deeper sorrow than anyone could ever imagine. As he prayed and his tears fell as blood to the ground in the Garden of Gethsemane. And they couldn't keep their eyes open to stay awake and to pray. And as Friday dawned, as the ancient alarm clock crowed a third time, Peter met Jesus' gaze and he wept. because once again he had failed at staying awake. Listen, loved ones, you can be ready. Jesus calls us to be ready. We're able to do it. The question is, will you choose to be ready? If you're faithfully serving the Master, don't stop now. Don't grow weary in doing good. Keep going. He's so close. If you're lazy, if you're distracted or focused on things of this world instead of things of Christ, wake up. The time is short, and our King is returning. And listen, if you're far from God right now, come back. There's grace for where you've fallen. Peter denied Jesus Christ, and there was grace for him. There's room for you, and his loving arms are open to receive you back into his Master's house. And if you have never yet made the decision to trust Jesus Christ by faith, you've never turned from your sins and believed on Jesus Christ by faith to receive his forgiveness, his payment on the cross for your sins and for mine. If you've never done that, it's not too late. The book of Hebrews tells us, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. So I just want to say, if that's you, don't harden your heart. All we're promised is today. Don't miss the opportunity to follow a loving and gracious God. In fact, we've given this opportunity before. You can actually text in to 797979. You can just text the word follow and somebody will reach out to you. We would love to tell you more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ. Today could be your day. There's room and we want you there with us. His call to all of us is the same expectancy that he has. Because Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you and you'll be with me. Jesus is expectant to be with me and to be with you. And we're to live with that same expectancy. So wherever you find yourself today, whether you're near to the Lord or whether you feel far off from God, his message to all of us is stay awake, to live in continual readiness for the return of our King. It's Tuesday. You know, just a few days ago, Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. And even now, as our suffering King prepares to go to the cross just a few days later, he's pointing to another day when he will ride in on a white horse. It's a much different entrance. And on that day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. For some, it will be too late. Don't let it be too late for you. Be ready and stay awake for his coming. Because we clearly don't know when he's coming, we know for certain that he is coming. Revelation 19 says, then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. He has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and a name by which he is called is the Word of God. The armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He is coming soon.
He's coming.
Jeff challenged us to be on guard. He also challenged us to remain in a continuous state of readiness. He also challenged us to make a plan for greater obedience. Such a blessing. God is coming soon. Pastor Jeff challenged us to be ready for that. I was blessed by that. Harvest, we hope that you are blessed by that as well.
Hey, Harvest family, as you think about this week and being on the ready, go with this truth stamped on your heart, that you are loved, and give it all that you have for the joy of the Lord.